Kids, you are released for our children's scripture time. A few of you there. Good notes on John Chrysostom. That's awesome. Good job, Ron. Hey, everybody. It's Christmas time, if you didn't know. If you didn't know about it. Here's what I want us to do first. Think of a gift that changed your life. Give you a few seconds. Give me a gift that changed your life. And now we're going to do something a little awkward, and it'll be okay. Tell your neighbor. If you want to, I'm not going to force anybody to. But tell your neighbor, what is a gift that changed your life? Mine is, about a month ago, my wife told me, Nick, you can keep the beard. Win. Awesome. Thank you, Amy. It's changed my life, just having this thing. I don't have to shave or none of that. It's good. Or I think of as a kid, I think the Super Nintendo would have been one of the things that changed my life. A good old Super Nintendo. I also think of, and this may be yours too, and that's good, and that's a good thing, when you met Jesus and believed in Jesus for the first time, that probably changed your life, which is a good thing. Second question, what is one gift that has changed somebody else's life that you have given? Catch that. What is a gift that you have given that changed somebody else's life? Say it a little different. And it doesn't have to be monetary. It could be you told somebody about Christ, and that's a good thing. That's a really good thing. It could be something that led to that too. Let's expand the picture a little bit. The circumstances or the what was happening in your life, that could be a gift that led you to Christ or this gift. So like a car ride that somebody gave you because they wanted to give you a car ride and you didn't have a car or you couldn't get to wherever you needed to go and somebody gave you a car ride. That's a gift to you. Or a cup of coffee. Somebody might have purchased a cup of coffee for you, had a good conversation with you, and that right there, that was a gift. A friendship could be a gift. A forgiven wrong, an invite to lunch, a plate of cookies is a good gift. Things that when you give those things, it affected the rest of your life. It led to a conversation, a newfound respect, something in your life changed that you still feel the impact on. And what I want you to see with those that little question is how gifts have changed our lives just all over the place. And I'd be willing to bet that most of our current situation in life is because somebody gave us something or some things or a lot of stuff. It's all a gift. And if you want to get really big picture, ultimately you did not make yourself alive. Your life is a gift. Your entire existence. And even if you're an atheist today and we love you and we're glad you're here, even if you're an atheist today and you think that this is all a bunch of random stuff that happened, you still didn't give yourself life. And that's not to put you down or anything, that's just saying that you didn't make that happen. You didn't make that happen. And I would say Scripture tells us that the life that we have is given to us by a creator. And so we're going to run with that today. And it makes sense, right? Somebody, like the gift you give was thought up by you and was given to somebody else. The gift that you are given was thought up by somebody and then given to you. So let's run with that and see what else he gave us. And we're going to be in Philippians 2 today, so turn there with me, which I got to look for it too. And I'll help you out about that far. Okay? End of the book, front of the book, a lot of pages, little pages. Philippians 2. Before we get in, I'm going to give you a little context to this as we see the gifts that we've been given in this, because Paul is writing this, and Paul has very clear thoughts, very clear logic in all of this. And so to back up a little bit before we dive into 2, I'm going to give you a little bit of context here. Paul is talking to these Philippians. They're good folks. The Philippians are doing a great job. But he says this in Philippians 1:21, and you may have heard this before. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which shall I choose? I cannot tell. So kind of a funny way of saying, hey guys, I don't know if I want to like go and die or stay here with you, because I'm hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. He has this mind, this thought in his head that Christ is way better than anything we can get here on earth. And so he's hard pressed between the two, whether to live or to die. He'd rather die and go be with Christ. So keep that theme in mind. He'd rather die to be with Christ than live here. But he says later, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy and faith. And kind of goes on to say, hey, I'm here for a reason. I'm living for a reason, and it's for Christ. He's got work for me to do, so I'll do it. So that's one thing to bring into our verses today. The other thing to bring in is that we are given belief in Christ and suffering for his sake. He says this later in 1:29, for it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake, engaged in the same kind of conflict you saw that I had and hear that I now still have. So he's touching on this gift thing. Christ is way better, but he's given us belief now, and suffering now is a gift. He's granted us to that. So this kind of like one coin, just two sides of it. One side's kind of a little scary, got some scratch marks on it. The suffering side, you know, it kind of looks kind of bad sometimes, kind of hard. But the other side is belief in him and just joy in the salvation that we have in him, and belief that he's come to save us. So he brings into that into Philippians 2. Let's read Philippians 2 and really dig in here. So if there's any encouragement in Christ, this is 2:1, just going straight through. So if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you not only look to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Have this mind among you, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the God the Father. Amen. That's a good passage. So with these themes that Paul thinks, hey, it's better to go die and be with Christ than to live. And hey, Christ, we're here and Christ has granted us belief in him and suffering. So now, what do we do with that? And how do we like reconcile that with our lives, and how do we reconcile that with what Scripture teaches? And so he jumps into verse 2:1. So if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort in love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy. And what he's doing there, he's showing us not if those things are true, but he's asking that question and saying if, because he believes that they are true. Did you catch that? So if there's any encouragement, he's not saying maybe there's encouragement out there in Christ. I don't know. He's not saying that. He's saying if there is, he's saying, yeah, there is, but I'm going to make your mind kind of work a little bit to realize that it's there. And it's true. He's coming from the assumption that these things are true. And he's asking the Philippians and us to kind of think about that. Like, if there's any encouragement in Christ, is there? Is there encouragement in Christ? Is there comfort in love? Participation in the Spirit, do we have that? Any affection and sympathy, do we have that? And what clues us into Paul's thinking here is the things that are here. And the things that are here that he mentions are from God. If there's any encouragement in Christ, Paul would say, yes, there is encouragement in Christ. You have a Savior, and the whole story of Jesus, you have the Savior that come to save humanity. There's some encouragement there. Christ promises paradise with them, help for now, and a hope and for a future that's led by him. That's encouraging. Is there any comfort in love? I would think that would be a thing that we would agree on, that there is some sort of comfort in love. That if you don't have love, but then get love, that's comforting. That speaks to your heart, that speaks to your soul, calms you down, makes you feel like it's going to be okay. Is there any participation with the Spirit? And for those in Christ who have believed in his name, we have the Spirit. There is participation in Christ. We saw that Pentecost happened when the Spirit fell, the fiery tongues came upon the folks, and they started doing stuff. There is participation with the Spirit. We see that. Even today we see that. There's stuff that still happens. Healings still happen. Miracles still happen. People get ideas about where to go and what to do. That's the Spirit. That's participation or fellowship with the Spirit. Is there any affection and sympathy? And this one's a little tricky, but I'm going to help you out a little bit. I've said this before, and I'll say it again. Exodus 34, 6 through 7 is a monumental passage where God talks about himself. And in that passage, there's a part where he says he has compassion and mercy, or grace and mercy, and kind of those two right there. Well, those ideas are in Paul's mind when he writes this. Did you catch that? So Exodus 34, 6 through 7 is God talking about himself. And what he says about himself is that he's a God full of compassion and mercy. And what Paul is trying to do is bring that idea in here into Philippians 2. So he would say, yes, there is affection and sympathy. And if you go in the Greek, you can see it a lot clearer. But understand that that is pointing to God's attributes, his eternal attributes of affection and sympathy, or compassion and mercy, that kind of idea there. So what Paul is saying is that these things are true because of God. So if there is these things, which is saying there is, God has those, he's given those to us. And then he continues on, complete my joy by being the same mind, having the same love, being in the full accord and of one mind. Do nothing fearing rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. So what Paul does, he's saying we have those things. We have this gift of God's goodness and his encouragement in Christ, participation in the Spirit, all those things in verse 1, we have those. So now let's go from those, be unified in what? In humility. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit. We should be a full accord, one mind, same love. We have the same thoughts, the same affection, same things we desire. And what we should desire is to not do anything from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. So Paul is telling us that the gifts of God enable us to become a gift. Saying you have these things, he's giving you those things, these wonderful things that are from his very own person and being. He's giving you those things. And where we move from there, we realize that we have a full bucket in Jesus, and that we can start looking to other people, humbling ourselves, and looking to their interests and not just ours. And the greatness of these gifts releases us to go do that. We're not looking to fill us up, because God is. So we can help other people be filled up. And let's just go ahead and destroy the whole idea of monetary gifts in verse 1. Paul mentions nothing monetary and all relational. And it's free. He gives that to us. Remember 1:21, Paul says, I'd rather die and be with Christ, because this is going to be full on tangible stuff in heaven when he dies. This stuff is so good that it changes how we live and enables us to not think of ourselves, but think of others too. Now I want to make a little caveat here and realize that I say those things and say that we have those things, and you may think, Nick, you don't know my life. That's not true of my life. I don't have any encouragement in Christ. I don't have any comfort from love. I don't have any participation in the Spirit. I don't have any affection and sympathy. None of those things. And Paul is assuming those things. So what I want you to do, if that's you today, we love you. This body and community wants to do what Scripture tells us to do. We love you, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to not listen to anything else I'm saying today. I got maybe about 10 more minutes. Not listen to anything else I'm saying, and I want you to seek those things. I want you to seek the gifts of God that Paul is assuming that we get in verse 1. You might say, I don't believe it, I don't feel it, therefore it's not true. I want you to seek them out. Remember, they're not found in people, they're found in God. This stuff is from God on high. Rest of the church, I want you to be there to show these gifts to people, to point the direction, how you have experienced these gifts. I want you to be able to point people to those things. Because if you're not experiencing the gifts of God, the encouragement of Christ, the comfort from love, the participation in the Spirit, the affection and the sympathy from God, how can you think of other people? That'd be super hard. And almost mean to tell you that. I'm telling you, go fill your bucket from God himself before you do anything else in this passage. Unwrap those gifts. It's a Christmas present, guys. It's Christmas. This is 2:1 is a present to you to go look for it. Because I'm believing that you'll find it. Paul's assuming that you're going to find it and experience those things. It may not look how you think, though. Be open, have an open mind about what this looks like. And I want to point you to one passage. It's Hebrews 12. Can you read that? I'm not sure if you can read that. Font's a little small. Sorry. It's Hebrews 12, 5 through 6. Because one of those things is discipline is a form of love. And not, well, we'll read it. Hebrews 12, 5 through 6. And have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, my son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and he chastens everyone he accepts as a son. And we have that in Christ. So don't neglect to see that as a gift to lead you away from the sins that are in your life and away from the way that your life is broken into these good things that he's trying to show you. So have a little bit of open mind. Ask somebody around you, but I don't want you to do anything else of what I'm saying today until you've experienced the gifts of God in this passage. Capiche? Okay, good. Okay, good. Second question I want to ask you is, have you accepted these gifts? There's one point where you say, I believe that they're there. It's hard to receive these things. Sometimes I know it's hard to receive gifts. Pride steps in. This passage is trying to get around that and say, no, humility, accept these gifts that God is giving you. They're so amazing. Paul would rather die and go be with Christ than not. So have you accepted these gifts? Have you said, yes, they're mine? That might be hard to say that the gifts that God is giving are mine. He is giving me them. And maybe it's some other thing that's in your life that makes you feel that way, puts a barrier in between you and the gifts of God. But he's saying that they're yours. Have you accepted them? And what's that barrier? And the last question that we'll continue thinking about is, how can you become a gift to others? He's given us everything. That is a lot of good stuff. That's filling your bucket. That's making you able to function in life even. So how can we become a gift to others? How has he enabled you to be a gift of others? How have you experienced these things? And how does that put you on a calling and a mission to go be a gift to others? Keep that in mind. We don't have to answer that right now. We'll flesh that out a little bit more because Paul keeps going. So keep that question in mind. Let's read the rest of the passage and figure out how do we do this. Verse 5. We're in verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves. So he's just got done saying, have one mind, this same mind, the same love, this unity, right? Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men? So to answer that question, we look to Jesus. It's because of Jesus that we even have this idea of humility. We have this encouragement in Christ. We have this amazing example of Jesus being humble. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ. This is not just saying he showed us the way. It's how a leader leads culture and creates culture. So if you think of other leaders in society and the people that follow them, there's a culture there that he's shaping it. That leader is shaping that culture into kind of what it looks like. Like leadership 101 is lead by example. And other people start doing it too. Jesus is showing us leadership 101. He's leading by example here, setting the culture for his entire church. Which is the greatest thing, and the big point of this passage is that the gift of Christ shows us how to become a gift. He showed us how to do it. And I know this is hard. The example of Christ is a heavy burden. Because we are not Christ, right? We don't have everything put together. We are not perfect. We are not God incarnate. That is hard. I mean, just look how Paul explains it to the Philippians. He explains it two ways. One is a theological way. One is a practical way. Verse 6, who though he was in the form of God, did not account equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. Paul's theology is here, is that form of God. He is God. He has everything required to be God. He is one of the three persons of the Trinity. Every necessary attribute to be God, he had all of it. All the glory, all the omniscience, omnipresence, omnipotence. There's a bunch of omnis that he had. Love, the joy, all that stuff in the Lord's presence, in the presence of the Trinity. And he didn't consider it something to be grasped. He didn't consider it something that he would just cling to and not share with anybody and just hang on for himself, like the rivalry and conceit that Paul is trying to get us away from. It's not his with this kind of scorn, this look of like, this is mine and I'm not giving it up. He didn't have that. Jesus didn't think that turning off some of his omniscience, his omnipresence, omnipotence, the lights to his glory, was a thing that he wouldn't do for you and I. And we can discuss what that exactly means and what it means for a God to take on humanity. I'm going to help you out a little bit, and it's going to, Merry Christmas, I'm going to give you a big theological word. It's called the hypostatic union. Yeah, you can laugh like, Nick, why? Why are you doing this to us? Hypostatic union says, in about the time John Chrysostom was around, a little bit before, they were talking about this stuff. They were having a bunch of discussions in the 300s about what does that actually mean for Christ to come down? And there are some heresies going around that said, well, it was just kind of an apparition. It was still God. He didn't actually take on humanity. He just kind of showed up and looked like a human. Well, that doesn't work because he's trying to save humanity. He has a body and blood that was broken. We see that. We celebrate that in communion. Well, maybe just hollowed out a human and wasn't fully human, but used the flesh and functioned like the flesh in there, like a disguise or something. No, then he still is not fully human. What if he completely changed himself and became less of a God and more of a human to do this? Well, then he's not God and worthy to be praised. So what they kind of figured out from Scripture, this passage included, is that there's one person. He's 100% God and 100% human. I'm not a math major. That seems weird. But that's how they understand it. And in the realm of ideas and just godhood and personhood and what that all means, it works out. He's fully God. He's also fully human. He couldn't do the things on this earth unless he was fully God. And he couldn't save us unless he was fully human. So, Merry Christmas, big theological word for the day. I'm sorry. Maybe that changed your life, a gift that changed your life. No, it's okay. So that's the theological stuff. Very high. Paul has this super high view of Christ. He's God incarnate. He's fully God, fully man. But he came down, he stepped down, he emptied himself to become a man. Because when he's here walking around on earth, he's not showing all of his glory. He's not showing every bit of him that's perfect and good. You see the man, Jesus, in his weakness and his hunger and his need for food and all that stuff. This is a great humbling experience that we could never mimic. He showed us Christ's humility as this huge thing. Next thing, verse 7. But he made himself nothing, taking the form of servant, being born in the likeness of men, verse 8, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. There's this theological way Paul understands Christ's humility and his example, and there's a practical way that he shows his humility. His entire life was obedience to the plan. His entire life was obedience to the plan that he and the Trinity came up with in eternity past and said, we're going to save sinful humanity. And second person of the Trinity, you're going to empty yourself and become a human and be obedient and die. That's the plan. And Jesus said, okay. He said, okay. His entire life was going towards the cross. As part of the rescue plan, he said yes to it. He didn't think that his godhood was something to be grasped, but made himself nothing and humbled himself by becoming in the likeness of men and obedient to the point of death. This is high humility. And this is a weighty example of a leader showing what it is to be humble. And God even gives him gifts too. There's verse 9 and 10 and 11. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That was granted to him at this point. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed upon him. He got gifts higher than we'll ever get. You say, Nick, that is such a lofty example. How can I ever take that example of Christ and make it into my life where I can live that out in humility and in service to other people? How do I do that? Do I just get a different leader? Do I just get a different person to follow and take examples from? And I would ask you, would you want a different example and leader of humility? This is dealing with reality changing stuff here. Would you want a different example of humility other than Christ? Someone else to set a culture for a church other than God himself in human form? Would you want somebody else to show you how it means to be humble with the life on earth, with just their ideas and their plan that they have to be humble and to serve other folks? Or would you rather have a God who became incarnate in his whole life from eternity past? He had this plan to become incarnate and die for people. Do we want a different example? An easier one, a less demanding one than verse 10, Jesus? And that's a tough question. That's a tough question. Because I think we do have good examples of people around the world in the church showing what it means to be humble and service and serving and thinking of other people before themselves. I think we do have good examples of people like that. But I don't want to say that and then take my eyes off of Jesus. I don't want to say that and look to somebody else for my example of humility. I want to look to the Savior of the world, God incarnate, is my example of how to not look just at myself, but look at other people. So here's what I want us to do. That's big. So I want us to get inspired by that. I want us to look to the example of Jesus and say, that is lofty, and I could never get there, and you would be correct, and that's a good thing to say. But I want you to get a little bit inspired. I want you to see what Jesus does in his life and try to do the same things. I want you to see what he does in his life and see how he affects a community. That's one thing that this verse is pulling out. Paul tells us that this is the mind among everybody here, to not look just at themselves, but look at other people and look at to their interests. It's almost like this big, what do they call it, psychological like experiments. Like, what if you stop thinking about yourself as much? Like, there's things you have to do, and we'll get into that a little bit. But then you look towards other people. Now there's 100 or so people looking out for everybody else. That seems like a good deal. That seems like something that I would want to try here in a church that follows Jesus. And you're saying, Nick, that still feels weighty. So I would remind you to not do this unless you have experienced verse 1 and experienced the gifts of God pouring into you, these wonderful things. So don't neglect the gifts that God has given you when I tell you this, because I don't want to put undue burden on you. I don't think Jesus shows us an undue burden. He oftentimes went away to pray to God by himself, get recharged, rejuvenated. There's times where he pulled away from the crowd and took his disciples on a boat. There's times where he just rested. He was human. He had to. But we start by unwrapping the gifts in verse 1 to get inspired by this. And some of us, and I know it's Christmas, some of us are running ourselves silly, trying to do stuff for other people. It feels like you're pouring out so much. And that might be true. You might be pouring out too much in Christmas. Too much to get the house ready, the food cooked, the presents wrapped or bought at this point. And you're just doing too much, and it's weighty, it's stressful. Like, he doesn't show us that. He doesn't give us gifts of stress and doing a bunch of stuff that just is wearing us out, tiring us out, and making us a little bitter, if we're honest with ourselves. There's verse 2:1, there's encouragement in Christ, there's comfort and love, there's participation in the Spirit, and there's affection, and there's sympathy in God, and those are gifts for you to unwrap. So don't get inspired by Jesus until you've unwrapped those gifts. Okay, let's say we've unwrapped those gifts. Now get inspired. Get inspired by Jesus. See how wonderful it is to take care of other people and to give a little bit of yourself, and see a bunch of other people give a little bit of themselves to make a huge difference in the life of a community, in a church, in a community that's outside the church in this neighborhood and around the world, in your workplaces, in your schools, all that stuff. Get inspired that our leader knows how to make wide-scale, culture-changing, just changes and wonderful things happen. Say that, but start small. Start small. We're not Jesus. We're not God incarnate. We can't do those things at that level. He's got to do them. He's got to inspire all of us, 100 or so people, to do those things, to make that big of a difference. So start small. 1% impact in whatever you're doing in your life because of this verse. To do nothing from rivalry or conceit, to drop those things because they're just focused on yourself and sucking life out of you even, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. And let each one of you look not only to his own interests, don't run yourself silly, but also to the interest of others. But start small. Start small with that. The other thing I think this tells us to do is to exalt Christ. There's still verses 9, 10, and 11, where God has highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. There's a point in here where we see this example of Christ, and we're led to worship. We're led to exalt Christ, and we have Christmas songs to help us do this, like to see how wonderful it is that God became incarnate and went to the cross. So this should draw us into that worship, into the exaltation of Christ, and say, yes, Lord, you are amazing. You've changed the world by your lifetime. Your lifetime here on earth set off 2,000 years of church history. billions of believers giving of themselves, being inspired to do so, and to lift your name up and preach people the gospel. There's a part where we do that and we see that and we say, yes, I want to be a part of that and I want to exalt Christ in that way. We also see that part of this is the cross. He made himself nothing, being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. And so we're going to do that today. We're going to celebrate that today in communion. And the way we do it for today, we got three tables up in the front. If you have believed in Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are welcome to the table. We want you to know that. How we do it is just, when you are ready, take the time in your seat to experience the gifts of God and to see how he has changed your life in these things. To sit and remember what it means that he died on the cross for you. When you are prepared in that way, maybe he's even prompting you to talk to a brother or sister that you have a problem with before you come to the table. That's biblical. Let's do that. We'll have space lobby in the back for you guys to do that. Once you are ready, come up, take the bread and the cup, either go back to your seat, go anywhere you want in the building, really, up to the steps up here to kneel if you want, and remember Christ and his body broken for you on the cross and his blood shed for you on the cross. And also remember, he tells us that he's gonna come and eat a meal with us again. So also remember that he's coming back. There's a resurrection. He just didn't come to die. He came to be risen again. We believe that he's risen again, and he's in heaven right now, waiting to come back. So remember that in this time. So let me pray for us as we move into this time. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the gifts that you have given us. Especially today as we look at Philippians 2:1, the gifts that you've given us there. Father, help us to experience those gifts. Help us to unwrap those gifts and take them willingly from you. Father, help us not to deny you the pleasure of giving us good things. Father, if we don't feel them today, help us to feel them, help us to experience them. Father, we thank you for the example that Christ is in humility and showing us how to live for other folks. Father, would you inspire us with Christ's example? Would you give us other people who are inspired by Christ's example to look to too? And Father, help us to see the cross and the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus. And how that was a gift to us. A gift to save us, to get us into your presence so that we can say something like Paul says in saying, I'd rather be with you than here on earth. Prepare the hearts of your people today as they take communion. And we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Kevin, too.